Hello everyone. Today we are going to start our unit number 4. In unit number 4 we have two parts. First one is interference and the second one is diffraction. So we are going to start with the first part, that is interference. As you know, in order to get interference, the main condition is that we should have a coherent source of light. And first we have to understand what is the meaning of coherent source. So two light rays which are coming from a source, those light rays, they are said to be coherent in nature if they can maintain a zero phase difference or constant phase difference. Or in some simple words, you can say if these two light radiations, they are coming and if they can maintain crust to crust or trough to trough correspondence, then these light radiations, they are said to be coherent in nature. And if you will see this example, then there is no crust to crust or trough to trough correspondence. Then this type of light is known as incoherent. So the main condition is we should have coherent light, means either zero phase difference or constant phase difference. But now the question arises that how we can get coherent light. If we have two independent sources, suppose you have two sodium lamps, similar type of sodium lamps, then these two sodium lamps, they will emit the light radiations. But the light which is emitted by these two coherent, so these two sources, that will not be coherent in nature. Means two independent sources, they can never give us coherent light. The reason is very simple, that in every light source, you will get the light when the atoms which are present in excited state, they will come down and they will emit their extra energy in the form of photons. Because the atoms which are present in excited state, they can stay there only for 10 raised to power minus 8 seconds. But the problem is, the initial phase of each and every source, if you have two independent sources, then the initial phase of this source is totally independent of initial phase of this particular source. So if there is change in the phase of one of the source, you cannot maintain the similar type of change for the other source. It means if you have two independent, even similar type of sources, then the light emitted from those sources can never be coherent in nature. So it means if you want to get coherent light, then you have to obtain that coherent light from a single source. So there are two methods by which we can get coherent light. So for the formation of coherent light, these are the two methods. First one is division of wavefront. Now you have gone through the examples of division of wavefront in your lower classes. Young's double slit experiment, that is an example of division of wavefront. As you know, in Young's double slit experiment, there will be a single source which will be illuminated by a monochromatic light source. Then there will be two slits, S1 and S2. I'm just drawing the experimental setup of Young's double slit experiment. You have the source of light which will illuminate this single slit. Then this will illuminate these two slits which are placed at a same equal distance from this single slit. So by the division of wavefront, these two sources S1 and S2, they will act as coherent sources. So division of wavefront or Young's double slit experiment, that is an example of this particular method. Fresnel biprism experiment, where you are going to combine two prisms and after their combination, again by the division of wavefront, you will get coherent light. Lloyd's mirror method, that is also an example of division of wavefront. Now the other method through which you can get coherent light, that is division of wave amplitude. And your unit number 2, in this unit we are going to basically discuss this particular method, that is division of amplitude. So interference in thin films, that is an example of division of amplitude. As you have seen, that when a soap bubble that is illuminated by white light, then you can see the beautiful colors in that soap bubble. So basically that is the interference of white light. So that is an example of interference in thin films, which can be divided into two parts. Thin film of uniform thickness and the second one is thin film of non-uniform thickness. Then a very popular experiment, Newton ring experiment, that is also an example of division of amplitude. And in your unit number 1, you have gone through this Michelson interferometer in Michelson-Morley experiment. So in that experiment, there was a Michelson interferometer, where again by the division of amplitude, you will get coherent light. So these are the methods where from a single source, you can get coherent sources. Now there is a quick review of the basic phenomena or basic principles of interference. Now the first one, if you have two light rays, one is having amplitude A1 and the second one is having amplitude A2. And if there is a constant phase difference of delta between them, then their resultant, when they were superimposed, then their resultant is given by this A1 square plus A2 square plus 2A1A2 cos delta. Now, this particular factor, cos delta, it will decide the conditions of maximas and minimas. And if you remember, then the condition of maxima in terms of phase difference, this term represents the phase difference. So, this I will be maximum if delta is even multiple of pi. And in terms of path difference, you can say this I will be maximum, or you will get the condition of constructive interference if path difference is even multiple of lambda by 2. And you will get minima if phase difference is odd multiple of pi, or you can say path difference is odd multiple of lambda by 2. So for maxima, this cos delta will be plus 1, and for minima, this cos delta will be minus 1. And these are the intensities of maximas and minimas. And one more point which you can see here, that whatever the gain in case of maxima, that is the loss in case of minima. It means during the formation of interference pattern, there is only redistribution of energy between maximas and minimas. Energy will remain conserved, but there will be a redistribution of energy between maxima and minima. Now in this unit, what you are going to discuss? You are going to discuss interference in thin films of uniform thickness, where the thickness of that thin film will be same at each and every point. Then you will discuss the thin films of non-uniform thickness, which is also known as bag-shaped films. And this experiment, which you will discuss here, the Newton ring experiment. And one point which you have to remember, that is Stokes' treatment. So basically this statement, this result was given by Stokes. So that's why it is known as Stokes' treatment. And according to this, if light is coming from a rarer medium towards a denser medium, and when the light is reflected from a denser medium, then there will be an additional phase change of pi. Or you can say there will be an additional path difference of lambda by 2. Means if you have this rarer medium with refractive index mu 1 and this denser medium with refractive index mu 2, and if light is coming from this rarer to denser medium, then at this point, particular point, some part of the light will be reflected and some will be transmitted. So when light is reflected from a denser medium, then there is an additional phase change of pi or additional path difference of lambda by 2. You have to remember this Stokes treatment. So this is a basic introduction of this interference. And in next lecture, I am going to start with interference in thin films of uniform thickness. Thank you.